Hi there, I'm Linda Lamesford, a producer of Central Texas Gardener. It's always so exciting when we see the first fireflies around our house for the season. But they've been there all along in our habitat garden, we just couldn't see them. So today, since everybody loves fireflies, we're meeting with Ben Pfeiffer, Texas Master Naturalist and founder of the Firefly Conservation and Research, who's going to give us what the flash is all about, the life cycle of fireflies, why they're disappearing, how we can attract them to our yards, and where they go when they're not flying around. Ben, thank you. It is so great to meet you at last.
Yeah, good to meet you too, Linda.
So tell us, how did you get involved with fireflies? Why are they so engaging, and what is the mission of firefly conservation and research?
Yeah, so I've been studying fireflies for over 10 years. About a decade ago, I had heard a report about firefly decline within the United States, and I thought that was a really fascinating thing. I had not heard that before. Like a lot of people hear about firefly decline for the first time, are really, you know, shocked about that they're declining. So as kind of a trained biologist, you know, when I went to college for, I started looking into it a little bit closer, and I had a really burning question. And that was like, what kind of diversity is here in Texas? And so for years, some entomologists from other states have kind of flown through here and identified some stuff, but nobody from actually from Texas specifically had kind of looked at it. So I kind of offered a unique perspective with it. The mission of the website is really just to educate people on fireflies in general, just more information about them and also about firefly decline and ways that they can help them come back from decline.
Now, exactly what are fireflies?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So fireflies are basically just beetles. And sometimes entomologists like to call them like squishy beetles because they're relatively soft bodied. But at the end of the day, they're really, they're not flies. They're not necessarily like bugs, but they're beetles.
And what you mentioned, you call them squishy beetles, squishy bugs, but there are also a lot of different names for lightning bugs.
Yeah, a lot of people call them a lot of different things. It just depends upon a lot of times what part of the state or the country you are. So sometimes people say that they're lightning bugs or fireflies or fire bugs. I've heard them called June bugs sometimes in some parts. But at the end of the day, they're all really just beetles. And I prefer to just call them fireflies because that's just kind of shorter. But you can call them whatever you like.
So what is it that causes them to flash? And understand there are a lot of tricks. The female has one lighting apparatus, the male has two. But how does it all work? What's this whole flashing thing going on?
When you see them out there flashing, it's one of those amazing things within like kind of the biological animal kingdom of flashing. It's a relatively kind of rare trait for insects. So a lot of people wonder what actually causes that. And it's really comes down to just two chemicals, basically. One's an enzyme, another's an amino acid, essentially. And one's called luciferase, and one's called luciferin. And these two compounds basically come together, and through the process of oxygen and releasing those oxygen ions, basically creates the flashing. And fireflies basically flash by breathing in oxygen. And so when they breathe in oxygen, what that does is it drives that chemical reaction that then causes the flashing. And as adults, they largely can control the flashing. As juveniles, generally they can't. So they kind of generally will just flash intermittently. But with each species, they have a different flash pattern, and it just depends on how fast that they breathe in and take in oxygen.
One of the things is that if we see them walking around in the day, we didn't perhaps know they were beetles. And so a lot of people, I get a lot of questions about this, squish them. They want to know how to kill them because they think they're evil. So tell us a little about the life cycle.
Yeah, so what most people don't realize is that fireflies actually spend most of their time in the larval state. And as adults, they only really live for anywhere from like 3 to 4 weeks. And some are even shorter than that. And so as adults, when they're flashing, looking for like a female or a male, it's a relatively short period that they flash. Some parts of the country, you know, the flashing only lasts for, you know, at least the term of their life cycle, 3 to 4 weeks. In Texas here, we're relatively lucky because we've got flashing fireflies throughout the early part of spring to sometimes all the way into the fall. You know, the flashing is a big part of that as an adult. But as the larval state, they live mainly primarily as kind of these like prehistoric looking glowworms that crawl along the ground. And a lot of times they live in the mud along a riparian corridor. And that's generally the huge chunk of their life cycle. And so, you know, as firefly scientists, we're really concerned about larval habitat. And so protecting that habitat so those larvae have a chance in order to become adults and then mate and then produce offspring.
And the larvae can actually burrow into, say, a plant container and kind of glow. So people see, you know, what's this glowing in my pot?
Yeah. And, you know, gardeners actually tell me a lot of times that they see this. And I'll have people that come to my presentations and they're like, yeah, you know, I had this, you know, these glowy things in this pot. And I'll get emails sometimes about it. And what happens is that there was a female firefly that end up landing in that pot, and it's usually a nice moist habitat with good soil, and so she'll lay eggs. And generally gardeners have really rich habitats because they provide a lot of nutrients in the soil, which attracts snails and slugs and stuff like that, which is food that fireflies eat. So, you know, occasionally in really rich areas, you'll get those situations where firefly eggs get laid in containers or in a garden, and then you see these glowing things that happen and people wonder what they are.
But they are beneficial, like you said. They eat the snail and the snail larva, and we're looking for natural pest control.
Yeah, they act as nature's pest control, essentially. They're part of the balance of the ecosystem, and they eat snails, slugs, kind of dead insects. As larvae, they're extremely predacious. So basically, you can imagine that they just constantly are eating, essentially, in periods where it's moist and there's abundant amount of prey. So they're really beneficial, and then they usually indicate the health of an environment. So if you've got firefly larvae, if you've got fireflies, it usually means you've got a really good rich habitat that's got a nice balance, and you want them in an environment.
So there are a lot of species of fireflies, so we may actually see different kinds in our yard.
Yeah, definitely. And that's kind of why I got involved with this, was to kind of figure out the diversity here in Texas. And in Texas, we've got about 45 species. And to provide context, the United States has around 200 species. So we've got a lot of species here. Texas kind of ranks up there along with like Georgia and Florida in terms of the amount of diversity that we have. So it's really high, and a lot of it has to do with the unique type of habitat that we have in Texas and different ecoregions. So you've got Edwards Plateau, Piney Woods, you know, West Texas, and they all tend to converge in certain spots. And what's over time through, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of years, it's created the right conditions for speciation to occur. So that's where unique species are able to come about. And so really nice diversity here, and it's worth protecting.
It is worth protecting. And one way we can do that is to stop the use of pesticides, because once we kill their prey, then we are going to kill them as well. But what else can we do just in our normal backyards? What can we do to encourage them?
There are a lot of things people can do to like help encourage fireflies. Believe it or not, you could actually, you know, take a suburban like backyard with like grass, convert it to like a slightly more natural habitat, or let's say even a garden or pollinator habitat, and over time generally attract fireflies to your yard because you're providing all the right ingredients. So what people can do is generally stop using pesticides, especially those that are really broad spectrum that like would kill any beetle. If you use a you know, pest control company, be sure to monitor like where they spray. For example, a lot of times they you know, kind of willy-nilly spray all over to kill everything. And if you have a little bit more conscious in terms of like telling them where you want it, that's a great idea, so you don't kill things that don't need to be killed. You can turn out outside lights, especially at night. Light pollution does impact fireflies, and it just is that, you know, males can't see females, and the light pollution in between interacts with them being able to find each other. You can, you know, introduce native plants to your habitat. That's a great one for retaining soil moisture. You can also buy land to protect species. That's a really great one, especially here in Texas, where people like a lot of wide open spaces and want to advocate a lot. And finally, you can kind of educate your neighbors. and, you know, kind of advocate for really good policies to kind of protect already existing habitat. And, you know, that's, especially in Texas, that's a really good one, because we've got a really big mix of, like, really growing state with a tremendous amount of habitat destruction that's disappearing. And, you know, we also have a large group of people that want to protect it. So we're in a kind of a weird kind of area. So, you know, protecting that habitat is really critical.
A very simple thing people can do, and we often say this on Central Texas Gardener for every beneficial insect, is to not be too tidy. We want to have some leaf litter, maybe some logs. And why is that? What is that going to, that's good for a lot of insects and birds, even, because yeah, they can hunt for insects, I guess, in the leaf litter, but it's especially valuable for the firefly larva.
Yeah. And to give you an example, I was at Cibolo Nature Center in Bernie actually last week, and I ended up coming across a female and a male, and she was actually living in a log that was along the bank. So, you know, kind of an old, you know, log. And so that was where she had established her habitat. And so she mated with a male and then crawled back into that log, essentially, and was going to lay eggs in there. And so that's a good example of, like, we don't have to be so tidy, you know, with it. And, you know, having that, like, leaf litter on the forest floor or in wherever you're at helps retain moisture in the soil. And that's where the firefly are going to live. So, you know, it, providing that place where you can retain some good moisture is a really good idea. So yeah, like, don't have, it doesn't have to be super, you know, neat all the time.
Great. I like that. So tell us, what is your website again, and what can people find there? You've got some incredible resources.
Yeah. So the website is www.firefly.org. I've got information on firefly habitat, information on why they flash, questions about firefly decline. There's also a field guide on there that I'm working on. It's not complete yet, so it's getting there, but a lot of different resources on there for questions you might have about fireflies in general. And so just a lot of really fun stuff there. It's great for kids. I've got some really fantastic firefly photos of Texas specific species, so go check it out.
I certainly will, and I really thank you, Ben, for joining us and for spreading your information and knowledge and encouraging us all to go outside and take a look out in the dark tonight. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Linda. Yeah, I would add, finally, I would get kids out there and catch fireflies. You know, a lot of times people are concerned about, like, actually touching the insects, but for kids to actually learn about them, they need to catch them. And so I usually advocate for kids to catch them, study them, and look at them, and then go ahead and release them. So that's a great thing that people can do right now, especially because they're still flashing.
Wonderful. Okay, we'll see you soon. Hope to find you again on CTG.
Thanks, Linda.